Good afternoon, students. Welcome to the 8th lecture on Embedded System Design course. So in the last lecture, we discussed about some part of the memory in which we have seen about the two types of the memory, that is random access memory and read-only memory. And also we have seen what are the different types of RAM like NVRAM, SRAM and DRAM and types of ROM like MROM, PROM, EEPROM and E2PROM as well as the flash memory. And next we'll be seeing about the three topics in this lecture. The first one is nothing but the memory type according to the interface. Memory type according to the interface. And second one we'll be seeing about a concept called memory shadowing. And after that we'll take up a topic called memory selection for embedded systems. So coming to the first topic, memory according to the type of interface. So there are two different types of interfaces generally for data transfer. So one is the parallel interface and other one is the serial interface. So when you say parallel interface, so generally if we have a microcontroller and a memory chip Suppose we are having, we are considering an 8-bit microcontroller, then it will be having 8 data lines, 8 data lines. And similarly, we are considering the memory chip also have 8 data lines. So we are considering them to be D0 to D7. So whenever these are connected in a parallel fashion, that means the D0 of the microprocessor is connected to the D0 of the memory, and D1 is connected to the D1 of the microcontroller. Similarly, up to D7 of the microcontroller processor is connected to the D7 of the memory. So this type of interface is called as the parallel interface, where the data lines of the processor or controller are connected to the memory data lines. Okay, so if you are considering an 8-bit microprocessor or controller, you will be having 8 data lines, and these data lines are connected to the 8 data lines of the memory. And next we have other types of interface called serial interface. So in serial interface, generally we can use I2C interface, I2C interface, or I2C interface. So that is nothing but a two line interface. That means it is having two wires per interface with the microcontroller. That is, it will be using two line interface for connecting with the microprocessor, microcontroller and the memory. And next you can even use the serial peripheral interface. So this number of wires depends upon the number of serial peripheral bus devices you are connecting in that system. So if there are n number of SPI bus devices, then the number of lines will be 2 plus n. So that's that are the types of the interfaces which you can use for connecting the memory to the microprocessor or microcontroller, or we can say core of the embedded system. So serial interface is commonly used for data storage like E2PROM. So when we are going for an E2PROM, so there we require a serial interface. And the memory density of serial interface, so memory density means how many bits of data we are transferring. So that that is indicated in the serial interface by kilobits, that means in terms of kilobits. And when you are going for parallel interface, so the data transfer bits can be represented in terms of kilobytes. Okay, so why we are saying kilobytes and kilobits in this case means this is an example for the parallel interface which we consider. So here what we are transferring is 8 bits at a time. 8 bits means it is nothing but 1 byte. So it is an 8-bit microprocessor or microcontroller, so that we are transferring 8 bits or 1 byte at a time. If you are going for 16 bit, it is nothing but 2 bytes. So like that we can take whenever we have a parallel interface, the data transfer will be in terms of bytes, So in general, we can just return it as kilobytes. Suppose we are going for a serial interface. So serial interface, so if these two devices are connected using a serial interface, so it need to send data bit by bit. So one bit after the other bit, it need to send the data. So these are nothing but the data transfer will be in terms of bits itself, in terms of bits. So in general, we can call it as kilobits for the serial interface. And we're going for parallel interface, the memory density is represented in terms of kilobytes. So here is an example, AT24C512. It is from Atmel Corporation, and it is an example for serial memory. It is an example for serial memory. Whatever this 512 in this represents the 512 kilobits. As it's a serial memory, its memory density is represented in terms of kilobits. And as we are saying it as a serial interface, it uses two-wire interface. So two-wire interface is nothing but an I2C interface. So this is about the memory according to the type of interface. We have generally two types of interfaces, parallel interface and serial interface. So parallel interface means the parallel lines of the processor or controller are connected to the parallel lines of the memory. And here in the serial interface, so the data will be transferred in a serial fashion, either using I2C or SPI. And next, when we are representing the memory density, in case of parallel interface, we will be representing in terms of bytes, that is kilobytes. And for the serial interface, it is bits or kilobits. And next topic we have is the memory shadowing. So this is very, very important. Why? Because you may be asked in short answer type questions like, what is memory shadowing? So why we are going for memory shadowing means the RAM access is about 3 times faster than the ROM access. So in RAM, we can access the location directly. That means data we can access from any random location. That means if we are having a 2000, you can directly go to 2000 and access the data. You need not transfer from 0 to 2000 locations to access the data. So that is the advantage or the feature which makes it faster compared with the ROM. So ROM need to access the data in a sequential fashion. So according to the timing parameters, we can say that RAM access is about 3 times faster than the ROM access. So shadowing is nothing but, shadowing of the memory is a technique adapted to solve execution speed problem in the processor based systems. So why? Because we'll be storing the program, or we can say the code, in the ROM. Okay, so whenever they are processor based systems, so this code will be accessed at a slower rate, so that the execution will take more time. So that can be avoided by using this memory shadowing. So generally, we can take an example as the personal computer systems or laptops. So you'll be having one thing called BIOS. So we call it as basic input output system. So what it stores is the hardware configuration information. It stores the hardware configuration information. So usually when we just on the laptop or desktop, so that will take some time for booting the OS. So in the time between when we on the PC and we can see the Windows login, so there is something going inside the system. So that is called as the BIOS booting up. So after BIOS, the operating system will boot up. First, BIOS will be read and the configurations will be taken, and that after that the OS will boot up. Okay, so usually it is read, and that means what are the BIOS settings, all the configuration settings are read, and system is configured according to it during the system boot up. So which is nothing but time consuming. Why? Because it need to read all the configuration settings, and only then it need to start the operating system. so that we can find more time consuming. That means during startup itself, the laptops or desktops will consume more time. After that, we can run it freely. But when we are operating it freely, so before that it need to boot up. So that will take more time. So what manufacturer have done is, so they included a RAM behind the logic layer of BIOS. They included a RAM behind the logic layer of BIOS. So BIOS is nothing but it stores the configuration, hardware settings, all that settings will be stored in the BIOS. BIOS is nothing but stored in ROM. Near saying a program or the settings, all that will be stored in the ROM. So what manufacturer have done is, so they kept a RAM behind the logic layer of the BIOS. They kept a RAM behind the logic layer of the RAM, so that we can say that RAM and the BIOS setting is being copied to the RAM. So what happens is, just see, so as a shadow to the BIOS, that means just we have kept RAM behind this BIOS. So this RAM will be acting as shadow to this BIOS. So what happens during system boot up is nothing but the BIOS will be copied, whatever the BIOS settings are there, all that will be copied into the RAM, all that will be copied into the shadowed RAM, or we can say the RAM which is kept in the behind the logic layer of the BIOS. So into that the BIOS settings are copied and RAM is write protected. Okay, so why? Because why we need to write protect means, if we don't write protect it, so that can change the configuration, and whenever we are making power up, so all this will be once again configured to the, if we are making any changes, so that will just change the system configuration and some device may not work properly. For that purpose, this need to be write protected. So this shadowed is being copied to the shadowed RAM and RAM is write protected. Then BIOS reading is disabled. So as we have the BIOS settings available in the RAM, so there is no need for accessing the ROM. That is nothing but actual BIOS. So BIOS reading is disabled after that. So here what happens is, as the BIOS settings, or we can say hardware settings, are readily available in the RAM, we can access the RAM at any time and any location or any setting from that. But coming to ROM, we need to access them sequentially, which will consume more time. For that purpose, this memory shadowing has been included. And next topic we have is the memory selection for embedded systems. Memory selection for embedded systems. So the memory requirement of an embedded system in terms of RAM and ROM is solely dependent on type of embedded system and the applications which are designed for it. Okay, that means for which type of application you are designing an embedded system, based on that you need to choose the RAM and ROM. Okay, there are lot of factors that need to be considered. So when you are selecting type and size of the memory, the type and size of the memory. Why? Because if you just have only one program, and there will not be any separate variables for that, for separate data to be stored, you can go for only ROM. Why? Because the program will be stored in the ROM, and that will be working, as there are no data variables that need to be stored. So the ROM is sufficient for that. Okay, so based on the requirements of the embedded system, you need to choose which memory need to be included. That means either RAM or ROM need to be included, or both of them need to be included, and also even the size also. Suppose that your code requires only 32 bytes, so you will be considering some 64 bytes. Why? Because the other 32 bytes, if at all you have an upgrade, and the code will be occupying some 48 bytes. So you need to have some buffer space for storing the upgraded or updated code. For that purpose, we'll be always having some size which is larger than the the code which need to be stored. So size and type of the memory. So for this choosing, you need to consider lot of factors. So we have some thumb rule for this one. As a rule of thumb, identify the system requirement. Identify the system requirement. That means if some of the system require more memory, so you need to, and also there is a program which will occupy more space. So you will be considering a RAM as well as the ROM. Okay, and based on the type of processor. So that whenever we are saying a processor, it may be a system on chip or a microcontroller with on chip RAM. So this is used for design and take the decision on whether on-chip memory is sufficient or external memory is required. So when we are considering an SoC or microcontroller with on-chip memory, you need to see that whether that application can be run with the on-chip memory or not. So if at all we can't run the application properly with the on-chip memory, then we need to go for the external memory. So based on that itself, we need to choose the decision. First, we need to identify the requirements, and based on the processor, next you will be doing selection of the processor. So which we have studied under the core of embedded systems. You may select a microprocessor or microcontroller. So generally, whenever there is a program, you will be preferring to have some on-chip memory. So based on that, you need to just check whether that on-chip memory is sufficient or not. If at all it is not sufficient, you need to go for an external memory. So that all, just you need to take in a step-by-step sequence. System requirement, then choosing of microcontroller, better prefer with on-chip memory, and after that, whether this on-chip memory is sufficient to store the program or store the data for the embedded system. If at all it is not sufficient, then go for the external. This is how you need to proceed when you are selecting the memory as well as the size. And next, if embedded design is based on an RTOS, okay, so you can have embedded systems with an real-time operating system also, but some of the embedded system may be just running a single code itself, but some of them has an OS, so that is RTOS, real-time operating system. So when you are choosing that type of embedded systems, so that requires certain amount of RAM for its execution and ROM for storing its RTOS image. So as it's an OS, so that OS image should be stored in the ROM. Why? Because whenever the system boot up, so that from that image the OS will be booting up, and whenever it executes the program, it need to use the RAM. So for that purpose, RTOS requires certain amount of RAM for its execution and ROM for storing the RTOS image. And next, memory selection. For memory selection, we'll be considering two parameters which represents the memory. One is nothing but size of the memory chip. So size of the memory chip does not mean the physical size. The size of the memory chip means the memory density expressed in terms of number of memory bytes per chip. Number of memory bytes per chip. So next, we also need to go for other representation. That is nothing but word size of memory. Word size of memory refers to the number of memory bits that can be read or write together at a time. That means number of bits which we can write or read together at a time, that is called as the word size of the memory. And the other one is nothing but the size of memory chip. What it represents is the number of memory bytes per chip we can store. How many number of memory bytes we can store per chip. So that is nothing but size of the memory chip. So generally, the memory size, memory chips comes with the standard sizes. So whatever the first one, okay. So this first one with comes with the standard sizes like 512 kilobytes, 1024, that is nothing but 1 kilobyte, 2 kilobyte, 4 kilobyte, just multiples of 2 you will be getting there. Okay, so like you can take up to even 1 megabyte also, even greater than that also. So when you select the, when you are selecting a memory size, always keep in mind the address range supported by the address range supported by your processor or controller. It is very very important. Why? Because so if at all you are going for a 8086 microprocessor, so 8086 microprocessor can support up to 20 address lines. So it is having 16 data lines and 20 address lines. Suppose if you are choosing a memory which is having more number of address lines, is greater than 20, that means 20 is supported by 8086, you are having an address line which is greater than 20 for the memory chip, so the interfacing will become problem. So better you need to consider the address range which is supported by the processor or controller, and based on that you need to choose the memory. So generally you can take 2 power n can be the memory size, where n represents the number of address lines supported by the processor controller. That means this n should be, that means memory, whatever the address range of the memory is there, that should be less than or equal to n. You can have equal to n also, and you can choose even less than n also, but it should not be greater than n. Why? Because the address range supported by the processor is n. We are saying the address range supported by the processor is n, then we can't go for the address lines of the memory chip with greater than n. We can go for with less than n or equal to n also. Next, you can find the different memory size or memory chip sizes here. 512, 1 kilobyte, 2 kilobytes, 4 kilobytes, like that, 1 megabyte. Next, coming to the word size. Word size supported by the memory chips are 4, 8, 12, 16, 24, 32. Okay, these are nothing but the number of memory bits which we can write or read at a time. Okay. So the word size supported by the memory chip matches this should match with the data bus width of the processor or controller. So as we have seen, with respect to size of memory chip, it should not be greater than the address range supported by the processor or controller. Similarly, when you are going for the word size, you need to keep in mind the number of data lines of the processor or controller. Suppose that if you are using an 8-bit microprocessor or controller, so you can have the word size as 8. Why? Because maximum you can transfer 8 bits at a time to the processor. So like that we need to choose. So you can even choose less number of bits than the processor or controller, but you should not choose the number of bits more than the microcontroller or microprocessor can support. So that's about the memory selection for embedded systems. In the next session, we'll see about the sensors and actuators. Thank you. And also please like, share and subscribe to the channel, so that you will be getting, and also press the bell icon so that you will be receiving the regular updates when I upload a video. Thank you.